PLDT has unveiled a hybrid modem which offers uninterruptible internet connection and peace of mind for its consumers. Jackie Pascual gives us a look.
So presenting,
PLDT Home launches an uninterrupted broadband service which automatically shifts from fiber connection to LTE if there is an accidental fiber cut or service interruption. The company claims this new hybrid modem is the first of its kind in the world. The company adds this is good news, especially for work-from-home employees.
As soon as your fiber connectivity dies, then you will have insurance in the form of connectivity via LTE, only for 299 pesos.
The modem will detect that something has happened, and then it will actually switch you over. Now that's a really, really big difference to how you may have actually set this up in your home.
The telco adds customers also do not need to call the PLDT hotline once a service interruption happens in their area.
Maybe someone unfortunately hit the pole, right? It happens. It happens. Maybe someone was doing some digging and they've actually cut up your cable as well, right? We'll then be able to send a technician out to your home, have that repaired.
You'll be able to know that a ticket number has automatically been generated as well without you informing our Get Help channels. And with that, it will already trigger PLDT to send a repairman to your home.
The company plans to add more features in the modem as they continue to talk to various vendors and companies to upgrade the device.
What you're really giving to your consumer is actually not a backup service, but you're giving them peace of mind.
PLDT has earmarked up to 78 billion pesos for capital expenditures this year to improve its fiber service, data centers, and submarine cables. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Here to the local corporate headlines that we're watching this morning. All right, Golden MV Holdings. Golden MV Holdings is changing its name to Villar Land Holdings. Of course, Golden MV is the real estate arm of Manny Villar, and its portfolio is a 397-hectare Villar City megalopolis. Meanwhile, Globe Telecom has signed a term loan facility with BPI for 3 billion pesos to finance capex, refinance debt, and other corporate requirements. As of the first 9 months of the year, Globe has already invested 41 billion in capex. That's actually down 24% year-on-year, just according to plan. And approximately 91% of that capex was allocated for data requirements. Asian markets waking up to a tepid day for U.S. stocks, with tech shares leading major indexes lower. A stronger yen is also weakening Japanese stocks after a rally in treasuries weighed on yields and the dollar. While futures for Hong Kong are up alongside Aussie shares, ASX 200 up by 0.4%. Central bank policy is also in focus here in the region, with New Zealand central bank cutting rates yesterday for a third time in 4 months and flagged more substantial easing. The Bank of Korea is up next. It's expected to keep its key policy rate at 3.25% today to support the Korean won against a strong U.S. dollar. Now, the end of the week is expected to bring more eventful data in Asia, with GDP figures due in India and Taiwan tomorrow, along with Tokyo's CPI data. Flipping the board, U.S. futures are looking up, all of them higher by about 0.1% each ahead of a Thanksgiving holiday. Of course, Black Friday, the day after Thanksgiving, also marks the unofficial start of U.S. holiday shopping season. The extent to which inflation-challenged shoppers flock to deals will be of interest to markets, with consumer spending making up more than two-thirds of U.S. economic activity. Now, Wall Street snapped its seven-day record-breaking rally rather on Wednesday, with the Nasdaq leading declines as tech stocks slumped on Thanksgiving Eve on worries the Federal Reserve may be cautious about rate cuts after stubbornly strong U.S. inflation data. Now, data showed the Fed's preferred measure of underlying inflation picked up. Well, in line with estimates, the core personal consumption expenditures climbed 2.8%. from October last year, while separate figures showed the economy expanded at a solid pace of 2.8% as well. Now, according to CME's Fed Watch, traders are adding to bets the Fed will lower borrowing costs by another 25 basis points at its December meeting, while leaving rates unchanged at its January and March meetings. Meantime, investors also still gauging the impact of President-elect Donald Trump's pledge on Monday to impose duties of 25% on imports from Mexico and Canada and additional 10% on Chinese goods unless unless these three trading partners stop the flow of deadly opioid, fentanyl, and illegal migrants into the U.S. The Goldman Sachs said in a note this week, an escalation in tariff policy risks delaying the return to 2% inflation target. Now looking at the board, let's now check out the board. The S&P 500 dropping by 0.4%. Well, the Dow fell by a third. The Bloomberg Dollar Spot Index also slipping by about 0.75%. Bloomberg Gauge of the Magnificent 7 megacaps down by about 1. Dell Technologies and HP tumbling at least 11% after their results disappointed investors. Now, the U.S. Federal Trade Commission has also opened an antitrust investigation into Microsoft, drilling into everything from the company's cloud computing and software licensing businesses to cybersecurity offerings and artificial intelligence products.
Well, stocks are down on the day before Thanksgiving, in a sense, as a repeat of history, where there's an old saying that the bears have Thanksgiving, but the bulls have Christmas. It does tend to be a pretty long weekend, so I think a lot of investors want to square themselves before the long weekend and look to buy back in once the new month starts.
In highlights from corporate America, we're watching Autodesk, whose CEO, Andrew Anagnost, said the company is focused on cutting costs in its sales and marketing teams, a move that comes following pressure from activist investor Starboard Value. While three companies, BlackRock, Vanguard Group, and State Street Corporation, are being sued by a group of states led by Texas for allegedly breaking antitrust laws by boosting electricity prices through their investments in what is touted to be the highest profile lawsuit yet against the beleaguered ESG industry. Finma Corporation set to expand its construction and housing initiatives following the completion of its stock rights offering that raised 1 billion pesos. A substantial portion of the proceeds will fund the development of the group's Trip by Wyndham Hotel, located within the firm's 21-hectare Saludad Township in Bacolod. In the SRO, Finma offered 50 million shares at 20 pesos each. Of course, this is the first time they headed back to the markets in nearly three decades.
This will go into new expansion plans for the group. In construction materials, we have a lot of projects underway. We have our cement projects in Davao. We also have, of course, our Union Insulated Panel Factory, which is our newest baby venture under the construction materials group. A lot of it will also go into our other segments within the group. So the properties group just launched, actually, our new township development in Bacolod, which we're very, very, very excited about. It's called Saludad. We launched this last October 19. It's a joint venture partnership with the Jacinto family, 20 hectares that we're developing in Bacolod.
One of the country's leading cryptocurrency exchanges, Coins.ph, has set new records for both trading volume and user growth this November. The platform announced it has surpassed its performance from the same period last year by more than 10 times, driven by Bitcoin's surge to new all-time highs and a growing influx of Filipino users into the crypto market. Coins.ph also revealed plans for global expansion with the upcoming launch of its global platform, Coins.xyz, in Australia next week, followed by its entry into Brazil next month. Now, Bitcoin is climbing back towards the elusive $100,000 price level again, snapping its longest losing since Donald Trump's presidential victory triggered a record-breaking rally in the largest cryptocurrency. Of course, it's currently trading at $95,952 apiece. It has more than doubled in value this year. We have this just in. Masato Kanda is elected as ADB president, as ADB's 11th president. He is 59 years old, currently serving as special advisor to Japan's Prime Minister and Minister of Finance. He will assume office on February 24th next year. He is succeeding Masatsugu Asakawa, who will leave office on February. Kanda-san will complete the unexpired term of the president, which ends on November 23, 2026. With nearly four decades of experience, Kanda-san has held key leadership roles at the Ministry of Finance of Japan, including Vice Minister of Finance for International Affairs. He has extensive experience in financial sector policy and macrofiscal policy, having served as Deputy Commissioner at the Financial Services Agency. The list is pretty long. He is actively engaged in the G7, G20, and other international forums, addressing key policy challenges such as multilateral development bank evolution, pandemic prevention, preparedness and response, and debt sustainability, as well as transparency. He obtained his Bachelor of Laws from the University of Tokyo in 1987 and has economics from Oxford University in 1981.